Hello friends, today we will learn about polymerase chain reaction. PCR, polymerase chain reaction, is otherwise known as DNA amplification. The polymerase chain reaction is a laboratory technique for generating large quantities of a specified DNA. PCR is a cell-free amplification technique for synthesizing multiple identical copies of any DNA of interest. It is developed in 1984 by Carey Mullis. He got Nobel laureate in 1993. PCR is now considered as a basic tool for the molecular biologist, as is a photocopier a basic requirement in an office. So is the PCR machine in a molecular biology laboratory. Let's know about the principles of PCR. The double stranded DNA of interest is denatured to separate into two individual strands. Each strand is then allowed to hybridize with a primer renaturation. The primer template duplex is used for DNA synthesis, and the enzyme used is DNA polymerase. There are three step process to get DNA. First step is denaturation, then is the second step is renaturation, and third is synthesis. These processes are repeated again and again to generate multiple forms of target DNA. Now let's know about technique of PCR. There are some techniques to know PCR. First point is a target DNA that should be 100 to 35,000 base pair in length. Second requirement is the two primers, that means the synthetic oligonucleotides of 17 to 30 nucleotides length that are complementary to the regions flanking the target DNA. Third point is four deoxyribonucleotides, that means DATP, DCTP, DGTP and DTTP. Fourth point is a DNA polymerase that can withstand at a temperature up to 95 degree centigrade, that is thermostable. The reaction mixture contains the target DNA, two primers, a thermostable DNA polymerase isolated from the bacterium Thermus aquaticus, that is TAC DNA polymerase, and four deoxyribonucleotides. The actual temperature to about 95 degree centigrade for about 1 minute, the DNA gets denatured and two strands separate. Now let's know about renaturation or annealing. Second stage is renaturation or annealing. As the temperature of the mixture is slowly cooled to about 55 degree centigrade, the primers base pair with the complementary regions flanking target DNA strands. This process is called renaturation and annealing. High concentration of primer ensures annealing between each DNA strand and the primer rather than the two strands of DNA. Now let's know about synthesis. The initiation of DNA synthesis occurs at 3' hydroxyl end of each primer. The primers are extended by joining the bases complementary to DNA strands. The synthetic process in PCR is quite comparable to the DNA replication of the leading strand. However, the temperature has to be kept optimal as required by the enzyme DNA polymerase. For TAC DNA polymerase, the optimum temperature is around 75 degree centigrade. For E. coli DNA polymerase, it is around 37 degree centigrade. The reaction can be stopped by raising the temperature to about 95 degree centigrade. The three stages of PCR in relation to temperature and time Each cycle of a PCR takes about 3 to 5 minutes. In the normal practice, the PCR is carried out at all in an automated machine. The new DNA strand joined to each primer is beyond the sequence that is complementary to the second primer. These new strands are referred to as long templates, and they will be used in the second cycle. The new DNA strand joined to each primer is beyond the sequence that is complementary to the second primer. These new strands are referred to as long templates, and they will be used in the second cycle. For the second cycle PCR, the DNA strands original plus newly synthesized long template are denatured, annealed with primers and subjected to DNA synthesis. At the end of second round, long templates and short templates, that is DNA strands with primer sequence at one end and the sequence complementary to the other end primer, are formed. The third cycle of PCR, the original DNA strands along with long and short templates are the starting materials. The technique of denaturation, renaturation and synthesis are repeated. This procedure is repeated again and again for each cycle. It is estimated that at the end of 32 cycle of PCR, about a million fold target DNA is synthesized. The short templates possesses precisely the target DNA as double-stranded molecules accumulate. Now let's know about sources of DNA polymerase. In the original technique of PCR, clino fragment of E. coli DNA polymerase was used. This enzyme gets denatured at higher temperature. Therefore, fresh enzyme had to be added for each cycle. A breakthrough occurred with the introduction of tag DNA polymerase from thermophilic bacterium Thermus aquaticus. The tag DNA polymerase is heat resistant, hence it is not necessary to freshly add this enzyme for each cycle of PCR. Now let's know about some key factors of optimal PCR. Primers. Primers play a significant role in determining PCR. The primers, 17 to 30 nucleotides without secondary structure and without complementarity amongst themselves, are ideal. The complementary primers can hybridize to form primer dimer and get amplified in PCR. This prevents the multiplication of targeted DNA. Let's know about DNA polymerase. Tag DNA polymerase is preferred as it can withstand high temperature. In the hot start protocol, DNA polymerase is added after the heat denaturation step of the first cycle. This avoids the extension of the mismatched primers that usually occur at low temperature. Tag DNA polymerase lacks proofreading exonuclease activity, which might contribute to errors in the products of PCR. Some other thermostable DNA polymerases with proofreading activity have been identified. Example, TMA DNA polymerase from Thermotoga maritima, PFU DNA polymerase from Pyrococcus furiosus. Now let's know about target DNA. In general, the shorter the sequence of target DNA, the better is the efficiency of the PCR. However, in recent years, amplification of DNA fragments up to 10 kilobase pair has been reported. The sequence of target DNA is also important in PCR. Thus, GC rich regions of DNA strand hinders PCR. Let's know about promoters and inhibitors. Addition of proteins such as bovine serum albumin BSA enhances PCR by protecting the enzyme DNA polymerase. Humic acids frequently found in archaeological samples of target DNA inhibit PCR. Now let's know about variations of PCR. The basic technique of PCR has been described. Being a versatile technique, PCR is modified as the specific demands of the situation. Thus, there are many variations in the original PCR. Some of them are now we discussed. Let's know about nested PCR. Sequence similarities between the target DNA and related DNA are very frequently seen. As a result of this, the primers may bind to both the DNAs, and therefore even the undesired DNA also gets amplified in PCR. Use of nested primers increases the specificity of PCR and selectively amplifies target DNA. In the first cycle of PCR, the products are both from the target DNA and undesired DNA. A second set of internal primers is now used. They will selectively bind to target DNA and amplification proceeds. Now let's know about inverse PCR. In the inverse PCR, amplification of DNA of the unknown sequence is carried out from the known sequence. The target DNA is clipped with a restriction endonuclease which does not cut the known sequence but cuts the unknown sequence on either side. The DNA fragments so formed are inverted and get circularized. That means DNA ligase is employed as a sealing agent. The circle containing the known sequences is now cut with another restriction enzyme. This clips only the known sequence. The target DNA so formed contains the known sequence at both the ends with target DNA at the middle. The PCR amplification can now be carried out. It may be noted that the primers are generated in the opposite direction to the normal since the original sequence is inverted during circularization. Now let's know about uncoated PCR. In the uncoated PCR, a small sequence of nucleotide can be attached to the target DNA, that is the DNA is uncoated. This is particularly useful when the sequence surrounding the target DNA is not known. The anchor is frequently a poly-G tail to which a poly-C primer is used. The anchoring can also be done by the use of adapters. As the adapters possess a known sequence, the primer can be chosen. Now, let's know about reverse transcription PCR. The PCR technique can also be employed for the amplification of RNA molecules, in which case it is referred to as reverse transcription PCR, that is RT, in short RT-PCR. For this purpose, the RNA molecule must be first converted to complementary DNA by the enzyme reverse transcriptase. The cDNA then serves as a template for PCR. Different primers can be employed for the synthesis of first strand of cDNA. These include the use of random primers, oligo-DT primer and a sequence-specified primer. Asymmetric PCR. Let's know about asymmetric PCR. PCR technique can also be used for synthesis of single-stranded DNA molecules, particularly useful for DNA sequencing. In the asymmetric PCR, two primers in a ratio of 100:1 are used. After 20 to 25 cycles of PCR, one primer is exhausted. The result is that in the next 5 to 10 PCR cycles, only single-stranded DNAs are generated. Now let's know about real-time quantitative PCR. The qualification of PCR products in different cycles is not as simple as projected by theoretical considerations. In practice, large variations occur. The most commonly used technique for measuring the quantity of PCR is by employing a fluorescence compound like ethidium bromide. The principle is that the double-stranded DNA molecules bind to ethidium bromide, which emit fluorescence that can be detected and DNA quantified. The synthesis of genes by PCR and the role of PCR in site-directed mutagenesis are described now. Let's know about random amplified polymorphic DNA, RAPD. Normally, the object of PCR is to generate defined fragments of DNA from highly specific primers. In the case of RAPD, short oligonucleotide primers are arbitrarily selected to amplify a set of DNA fragments randomly distributed throughout the genome. This technique, random amplified polymorphic DNA, is known as arbitrarily primed PCR, AP-PCR. The procedure of RAPD is comparable to the general technique of PCR. This method basically involves the use of a single primer at low stringency. A single short oligonucleotide, usually a 9 to 10 base primer, binds to many sites in the genome and the DNA fragments are amplified from them. The stringency of primer binding can be increased after a few PCR cycles. This allows the amplification of best mismatched RAPD can be carefully designed so that it finally yields genome-specific band patterns that are useful for the comparative analysis. This is possible since genomic DNA from two different individuals often produces different amplified patterns by RAPD. Thus, a particular DNA fragment may be generated for one individual and not for the other. And this represents DNA polymorphism, which can be used as a genetic marker. RAPD is widely used by plant molecular biologists for the genetic identification of plant species. For this purpose, different combinations of nucleotides, most of them random oligonucleotide primers, have been designed and are commercially available. As each random primer anneals to a different region of DNA, many different regions of loci on the DNA can be identified. RAPD is thus useful for the construction of genetic maps and as a method for genomic fingerprinting. Now, let's know about the limitations of RAPD. The main problem of RAPD is associated with reproducibility. It is often difficult to obtain similar levels of primer binding in different experiments. It is therefore difficult to correlate results obtained by different research groups on RAPD. Now, let's know about AFLP, Amplified Fragment Length Polymorphism. AFLP is a very sensitive method for detecting polymorphism in the genome. It is based on the principle of restriction fragment length polymorphism. AFLP may be appropriately regarded as a diagnostic fingerprinting technique that detects genomic restriction fragments. In the AFLP, PCR amplification rather than Southern blotting is used for the detection of restriction fragments. It may be noted that AFLP is employed to detect the presence or absence of restriction fragments and not the length of these fragments. This is the major difference between AFLP and RFLP. AFLP is very widely used in plant genetics. It has not proved useful in the mapping of animal genomes, since this technique is mainly based on the presence of high rates of substitutional variations which are not found in animals. On the other hand, substitutional variations resulting in RFLPs are more common in plants. The basic principles of AFLP involves the amplifications of subsets of RFLPs using PCR. A genomic DNA is isolated and digested simultaneously with two different restriction endonucleases EcoR1 with a 6 base pair recognition site and MMSIL with a 4 base pair recognition site. These two enzymes can cleave the DNA and result in small fragments which can be amplified by PCR. For those purposes, the DNA fragments are ligated with EcoR1 and MMSIL adapters. These common adapter sequences serve as primer binding sites on the restriction fragments. The DNA fragments can be amplified with FLP primers, each having only one selective nucleotide. These PCR products are diluted and used as templates for the selective amplification, employing two new FLP primers that have two or three selective nucleotides. After the selective amplification by PCR, the DNA products are separated on a gel. The resultant DNA fingerprint is identified by autoradiography. AFLP fragments represent unique positions in the genome and hence can be used as landmarks to bridge the gaps between the genetic and physical maps of genomes. In plants, AFLP is useful to generate high-density maps. Now let's know about RAS, rapid amplification of cDNA ends. Reverse transcription followed by PCR, that means RT-PCR, results in the amplification of RNA sequences in cDNA form. But the major limitation of RT-PCR is related to incomplete DNA sequences in cDNA. This problem is solved by using the technique rapid amplification of cDNA ends. The target DNA is converted into a partial cDNA by extension of a DNA primer. This DNA primer was first annealed at an interval position of RNA not too far from the 5' end of the molecule. Now addition DATP and terminal deoxynucleotidyl transferase extends the 3' end of the cDNA. This happens due to the addition of a series of AAs as to cDNA. This AAs series now act as the primer to anneal to the anchor primer. A second strand of DNA can be formed by extending the anchor primer. The double-stranded DNA is now ready for amplification by PCR. This procedure is called 5' RAS since it is carried out by the amplification of the 5' end of the starting RNA. Similar protocol can be used to carry out 3' RAS when the 3' end RNA sequence is desired. Now, limitation of RAS. Since a specific primer is used, specificity of amplification of RAS may not be very high. Another disadvantage is that the reverse transcriptase may not fully reach the 5' ends of RNA, and this limits the utility of RAS. In recent years, some modifications have been done to improve RAS. Now let's know about applications of PCR. The advent of PCR continues to have tremendous impact on molecular biology. The amplification of PCR are too many to be listed here. Some of them are selectively and very briefly described. Let's know about the PCR, other applications of PCR. PCR in clinical diagnosis. The specificity and sensitivity of PCR is highly useful for the diagnosis of various diseases in humans. These include diagnosis of inherited disorders, genetic diseases, viral diseases, bacterial diseases, etc. The occurrence of genetic diseases frequently identified by restriction fragment length polymorphism, RFLP, can be employed only when there is a mutation resulting in a detectable change in the length of restriction fragment. Many genetic diseases occur without the involvement of RFLP. For all such disorders, PCR techniques is a real boon as it provides direct information of DNA. This is done by amplification of DNA of the relevant region followed by the direct analysis of PCR products. Let's know about prenatal diagnosis of inherited diseases. PCR is employed in the prenatal diagnosis of inherited diseases by using chorionic villus samples or cells from amniocentesis. Thus, diseases like sickle cell anemia, beta thalassemia, and phenylketonuria can be detected by PCR in these samples. Diagnosis of retroviral viral infections. PCR from cDNA is a valuable tool for diagnosis and monitoring of retroviral infection, example HIV infection. Next is diagnosis of bacterial infections. PCR is used for the detection of bacterial infection, example tuberculosis by Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Diagnosis of cancers. Several virally induced cancers. Cervical cancer caused by human papilloma virus can be detected by PCR. Further, some cancers which occur due to chromosomal translocation involving known as genes are identified by PCR. Here chromosome should be 14 and 18 in follicular lymphoma. Now let's know about PCR in sex determination of embryos. Sex of human and livestock embryos fertilized in vitro can be determined by PCR by using primers and DNA probes specific for sex chromosomes. Further, this technique is also useful for detect sex-linked disorders in fertilized embryos. Now, let's know about PCR in DNA sequencing. As the PCR technique is much simpler and quicker to amplify the DNA, it is conveniently used for sequencing. For this purpose, single strands of DNA are required. In asymmetric PCR, preferentially amplification of a single strand is carried out. In another method, strand removal can be achieved by digesting one strand, usually done by exonuclease by its action on 5' phosphorylated strand. Now let's know about PCR in gene manipulation and expression studies. The advantage with PCR is that the primers need not have complementary sequence for the target DNA. Therefore, the sequence of nucleotides in a piece of the gene can be manipulated and amplified by PCR. More details on this technique referred to as site-directed mutagenesis are given else. By using this method, coding sequence can be altered to synthesize protein of interest. Further, gene manipulations are important in understanding the effects of promoters, initiators, etc. in gene expression. PCR is important in the study of mRNAs, the products of gene expression. This is carried out by reverse transcription PCR. Now, let's know about PCR in comparative studies of genomes. The differences in the genome of two organisms can be measured by PCR with random primers. The products are separated by electrophoresis for comparative identification. Two genomes from closely related organisms are expected to yield more similar band. For more details, refer the technique random amplified polymorphic DNA. PCR is very important in the study of evolutionary biology, more specifically referred to as phylogenetics. As a technique which can amplify even minute quantities of DNA from any sources, that means hair, mummified tissues, bone, and any fossils material, PCR has revolutionized the studies in paleontology and archaeology. The movie Jurassic Park has created public awareness of the potential application of PCR. PCR in forensic medicine. A single molecule of DNA from any sources, that means may be blood, bloodstain, hair, semen, etc., of an individual is adequate for amplification by PCR. Thus, PCR is very important for identification of criminals. You can maybe refer DNA fingerprinting technique. Now let's know about PCR in comparison with gene cloning. PCR has several advantages over the traditional gene cloning technique. These include better efficiency, minute quantities of starting material DNA, that cost effectiveness, minimal technical skill, time factor, etc. In due course of time, PCR may take over most of the applications of gene cloning. Thank you. Finally, PCR is completed. Any question regarding this, you can ask me in the comment box. Thank you.